It's that time again, Our Town Live, where friends, family, people you know share with us their unique bits of wisdom. And now, here's Herb, your host, for another show.
We're lucky to have back with us one of the most popular guests, Stacey Chillemi. Stacey is on a mission to transform the health of millions worldwide. The author of The Complete Guide to Natural Healing, she is a believer in maintaining optimum health using alternative medicine, herbal supplements, fruits, vegetables, and vitamins. She believes that this type of lifestyle helps, in the long run, do away with unnecessary medicines and over-the-counter drugs that pose a threat to our health. Stacey is the founder of The Complete Herbal Guide and a recognized health and natural remedies expert with more than 20 years in practice as a health coach. Since her last podcast, we have had hundreds of requests on how to deal with the loss of hair for men and women. Stacey is here with some great tips on how to naturally deal with this issue.
This is a typical issue that many people deal with in life. Surprisingly, I didn't know myself, but it was over 5 million men and over 3 million ladies will be affected by hair loss. And hair loss, one of the main causes of hair loss and hair thinning is DHT. And this is caused by the blockage, by blocking DHT, it blocks your hair follicles and prevents hair growth. And so what I have found is that when I was doing a lot of articles and I was doing a lot of writing and about hair loss and hair thinning, and I was so surprised how many women are very interested in finding out about hair loss and finding out ways that they could prevent hair loss and hair thinning from occurring, because it's more acceptable in society with men. You know, a lot of men will shave their head, you'll see, like when they lose their hair, or they'll figure out ways of trying to hide it a little bit. But for women, it's very noticeable, and it's very embarrassing for a woman. And a lot of people don't know what to do. And what I had found is that I had been introduced to a product called, they have a couple different products. They have a maximum hair thickening serum, and they have a regrowth treatment, and they have the shampoo and conditioner, which is really popular. And I had gotten the shampoo and conditioner, and the company I was very impressed with. It was Hair Restoration Laboratories, and they have all these ingredients that helps with the blockage of DHT in their shampoo and conditioner, and it has helped many women and many men as well with the regrowth of hair and blocking the DHT from causing the hair loss and hair thinning. I've been using it myself, and even my hairdresser told me that she felt like my hair has been the thickest it's ever been. And I've been really excited about this product. I also tell people, too, like, you know, when it comes to hair loss and hair thinning, a lot of people don't realize, but the way we take care of our hair, too, can help with hair loss and hair thinning. You know, some people tend to wear a lot of hats. You see a lot of guys wearing baseball hats. That, you know, kind of hurts their hair circulation on your head and can cause hair loss. You also find that a lot of women like to blow their hair, and you know they tend to use different types of curlers and hair thinners. And some girls will go for, you know, and women will go for hair straightening treatments. These are all things that actually can hurt the hair and cause hair thinning as well.
What about,
you know, there are
dyeing your hair?
You know that too much dyeing and too much bleaching of the hair causes dryness. Can cause dryness, depending on what you use. And you know, a lot of hair salons, I know the place I go to, Cosmos and Freehold, they use actually organic products, because it helps with the to make the hair, keep the hair moist and not grow dry. Because a lot of times when you put all this stuff consistently month by month on your hair, it will dry out the hair if you're not taking care of your hair properly, and it could cause breakage and damage to the hair. Mm-hmm. So it's very important when you do get your hair, because even guys get their hair dyed too. A lot of guys will get that gray dyed out of their hair. But you do that consistently, and you could hurt your hair as well. So you constantly have to, cholesterol is great to put in your hair too. Cholesterol, when you put cholesterol in your hair, it helps with the moisturization of the hair. It keeps your hair moist so you don't have that breakage and that damage. And some women will actually put the cholesterol in their hair. And the old school ways, they used to wrap it up with aluminum foil and keep it there for a couple hours, walk around the house, and it would actually develop heat and go into the pores and into the skin and into the hair and help with the moisturization.
Is there anything special that people should not eat or should eat to take care of their hair?
I do know that pumpkin seed oil is good for your hair. They talk about how you can use pumpkin seed oil, and you can purchase it, and then you can actually shampoo your hair with a mild shampoo after you had put. What you could actually do is you roast the seeds at 140 degrees Fahrenheit for a few minutes. Don't burn them, and then the oil will come out from the seeds. And you could actually put, when the oil is cooled down, you could actually put it in your hair with a mild shampoo, and it will go into the pores, and the pumpkin seed oil is actually pretty good for your hair. Well, rosemary oil is actually one of the best natural blockers for DHT. There was a great study that was done on mice, actually, and it proved positive effects on the hair, according to the study that it was done. Rosemary oil performed as well as minoxidil, and it was an ingredient that is an ingredient actually to promote hair growth and used for hair growth treatment.
You say that you're on a mission to transform the health of millions of people worldwide.
Well, you know, I started out with epilepsy at the age of 5. I think we talked about that last time.
We did.
When I started to do natural healing, my health changed dramatically when it came to detoxing the body, changing the way I ate, the way I slept, just overall, everything about just changing my way of living. My body and my seizures improved dramatically. I was able to focus better, think better, my energy level increased, and people don't realize that everything we put in our body, you know, our body either accepts and rejects, and it plays a toll on our body, and after, you don't really realize it at first, but as time goes on, all these toxins and all these impurities that we take in our bodies and the lack of sleep and everything else puts a real stress on the body, and that's when illness occurs, that's when a lot of different things start to occur. And then people don't realize how to, you know, what's going on with them. Some people like just go to the medicine cabinet and or they go to the doctor and they just prescription, and then that leads to side effects and that leads to, you know, other things, and then the whole thing goes on. So if people just focused on how they care for their bodies, and stress too. Stress is 90% of our illnesses are caused by stress. So people, you know, have to learn too. And we live in a stressful environment. You know, there's always stress in everybody's lives. How do we go about trying to cope with stress so it doesn't affect our health?
You're primarily a believer in natural healing, correct?
Well, you know, I take medication. Like, if my body is not healing naturally, I do go to the doctor, and I will get a prescription. I'm not against medication, for medication. But, you know, first, let's try to see if we can heal it naturally, see what we can do. And then if it's not working, definitely go to the doctor.
When did you have your first, quote-unquote, epiphany about your body and how to do something about your illness? Or not your illness, but... with your ailments?
On natural healing, I was working for an herbalist and I was doing a lot of research for him. And a lot of the stuff, I started to apply a lot of these things to my own life. And that's when I started seeing a traumatic change in my health. And then I realized that it was actually changing the way we live, changing the way we care for our bodies can actually have a huge impact on our health. And so when I started to do things to naturally to help my own health, and I saw such a traumatic change, I thought, wow, this is great. I said, you know, if it can help me, it can help my seizures, imagine what it could do to other people and other people's lives. And then I started to make a little blog on Blogger many years ago, And 400 people came on, and they were listening to my articles and reading them. And then all of a sudden, 400 went to 10,000. Then I created a little website. And then one day I was working with a website designer, and he asked me, he would create the websites and I would create the content for him. And he said, you know, I can make this website really nice for you, Stacey. And I said, oh, I'd love that. And he redesigned the website, and that website grew up to over 450,000 people started coming on to it. And today, you know, people come on and I talk about, and I have a lot of doctors and a lot of different health specialists and people in the health industry talk about not just herbs, but everything about sleep, about exercise, about nutrition, because it's not just about, you know, just one thing. It's overall. It's everything. Everything, how we take care of ourselves overall. So that's how it kind of grew from a little something to a huge something, really huge. And you know, I've done many speaking events, and I'm on many advisory boards because people just want to hear my opinion on a lot of different topics. And you know, I've been helping a lot of people, and I've helped myself. So really love to you know, go out there, and I just want to help as many people that are open to change and want to improve their lives.
Natural healing aura. What does that mean?
Mm-hmm. Basically, natural healing is just is trying to look at things from a more natural perspective, trying to figure out how we can change our diet, how we can incorporate the food, you know, the food for medicine, basically. It's like people don't realize, but a lot of the foods we eat have so many nutritional values and vitamins and supplements in them, and they could actually, you know, the food we eat could actually heal our bodies alone. We have so many different types of foods that we, you know, everyone is in a rush environment where there's so many foods that are prepared for us and have ingredients that are so unhealthy and bad for the body. We're always on the go, and we're always trying to do things quick. But food can be your best source of medicine sometimes.
What are your favorite, or what herbal remedies do you suggest people use? What are their basics?
It really depends on the person and how the person, what the person is looking for. But I always suggest that it's good to incorporate foods that build the metabolism and help and energy levels. You know, because as we get older too, as you know, life gets harder as we get older, and our metabolisms go down, and it's harder to sleep at night because we're not developing as much melatonin. Our strength levels decrease a little, and we can't do what we used to be able to do. So trying different foods that can bring up the energy levels, and, you know, foods with nutrition are great substitute, you know, to help our body. I always believe, I'm a firm believer in vitamins, because as we get older, we do need a little help. I think it's good to have a multivitamin. I think it's good to have a little zinc in your body, and, you know, to have a little vitamin D, and just the vitamins that, you know, a lot of us tend to lack as well.
If I just feel tired most of the day, what could I do for a self-healing issue that I have no pep? What do you recommend I do?
So for energy, I feel it's very important to what you eat in the morning, and to have a good breakfast in the morning. So I liked having organic beetroot powder is really good. I think it increases the energy level and helps with energy and boosting your level, so you can actually have a little bit more oomph in the morning. I like to, I think having a good amount of protein in your diet is also very helpful. When someone works, you know, when is looking for to increase their energy, you know, they really have to start changing their diet, and, you know, eating more protein in their diet, and also exercising, because that helps with your blood circulation. You can have as little as 15 minutes of exercise a day, and that could have a huge impact on the way you feel and your body.
All the things you write about and talk about, what excites you the most to talk about as far as the natural side of healing and taking care of yourself?
I believe in power of positive thinking. Changing your aspect on how we look at life and how we feel has a huge impact on our, you know, our health too. Also coping with stress too. If you have a negative outlook on life, or if you tend to hang around people that are negative, the negative energy and can also draw you down and also change the way you feel and the way you think. I think it's very important to look at life and try to focus on the good things in life. And I truly believe that everything happens for a reason in life. We all go through, you know, obstacles, and we go through a roller coaster in life. But the way we view it and the way we deal with things can have a huge impact on how we feel, how we actually accomplish our goals in life, and how we move ahead. So I'm a firm believer in positive thinking. I believe that it's also, you know, we need to learn how to cope with stress in our life, because stress has a huge impact on our health and could interfere in our lives in many ways. And trying to cope with life in a more productive way, the stress in life could actually have a huge impact on your mentality, spirituality, and your health overall.
Are you a religious person?
Yeah, I am a religious person. I am not like overly religious person, but I am religious, definitely.
What is a good way to relax?
I like meditation and I like yoga. Those are two things that are very helpful. They help with relaxing the body. They also help with your focus. Lavender is a nice essence. Oil. It's a smell that a lotion you could put on your body, and it tends to, the lavender tends to relax the body. You know, some people like it or they hate it, and you know, I feel that it's great and very helpful for relaxation. Also, potassium and magnesium. Those are two minerals that are very good. You can even find them over the counter, and they tend to relax the body, and they can actually help decrease the level of stress as well. A lot of people like to take it at nighttime, because a lot of times a lot of people have problems where their mind is constantly thinking and they can't relax. Even when they want to go to bed at night, they're still thinking about the next thing they have to do tomorrow morning. So magnesium, potassium is great for relaxation.
You write about creativity.
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean by creativity?
It's great about be creative. You know, we all have a creative side to us. We need to find it in ourselves. And everyone has, you know, we all have our strengths and our weaknesses. And I find that, you know, I like to create things for people that I feel are going to be helpful and also bring a level of achievement and joy to my own self as well. I find that we all can use our level of creativity to help others as well and to make ourselves feel good as a person.
How do we examine ourselves to determine how we could be more creative?
I think that's where meditation sometimes comes in, you know, when you tend to relax and you tend to have deep thought about the positive strengths. And you could also write it down in a notebook. I always suggest having, you know, people to have their own little notebook where they can actually, you know, write down their short-term and long-term goals, what their positive strengths and what their weaknesses are, where they want to see themselves in a week from now, a month from now, 5 years from now, what brings the most joy to them, writing down their emotions and writing down what things in life they would love to accomplish. Maybe they don't feel they can, but they always wanted to, that dream in the back of their head. And by writing journals and creating and looking at ourselves deeply, we can actually figure out what our true passion in life is.
When you say writing a journal, for instance, or creative writing, should that be mm-hmm. done just for yourself, or should it be done with the intention of making money with it?
No, I don't think it should have the intention of making money. I think you should make a journal and create it for your own personal satisfaction and joy. You need to, when you do things in life, you should do it not for the intention of money, but you should do it for the intention of helping yourself or helping others, but for the fact that you want to actually help an individual, you know, and not think about the monetary, what you can make monetary, because I feel that's the completely wrong way to go about anything. Really, in life, you know, the most satisfaction I've found in life is by helping others and bringing joy to others. I don't think the monetary, you know, that should be the main focus.
How many hours a day do you work at keeping your website up to date?
Oh, gosh. It depends what's going on, but I can be from 7 to 12 hours. I could be on the computer depending on the projects and the things I have to do for the website, because we have a very large website. We have a website with over 5,000 articles and constantly different things going on and content coming in from different people, and keeping the front end of the website always making it look well and keeping the back end well. It takes a lot of time and it takes a lot of effort, and I tend to find myself on the computer a lot, but then I try to pull myself away, because then you can mentally drain yourself. So you have to really be smart as well and worry about, you know, your health comes first.
How do you keep that type of work from becoming too stressful? I'm sure you enjoy doing what you do, but how do you keep it from being too stressful?
You have to, I think, put guidelines down, and you have to give yourself limitations and say when enough is enough, and, you know, focus on the things in life that matter, like your family, and you focus on the important things in life, and not let something become so overwhelming that you just focus on that, and you put it as your... You have to look at what your first priority in life is and focus on that.
I'm sure a lot of my listeners would like to know, is this an income source for you to live on, or just a passion that you do, or both?
It's both. I make income off of it, but it's mainly, you know, it is a true passion. It started out with something. I've written over 20 books, and, you know, most of my books have been focused on helping others and helping people improve their lives, because everybody goes through something in life, but sometimes we just don't know how to overcome it. We all go through journeys in life, and I've learned in life things that were very helpful to me that I feel could be helpful to many others, and that's what I try to teach, and that's how it all started.
If they have more questions about hair loss or any of the other things we spoke about today, again, they should get you at StaceyChillemi.com. Correct?
Yes, they could do that. And we also have the regular website where they can go on the contact form, and that's thecompleteherbalguide.com. Either website, we would be happy to get back with them as soon as possible and help them as much as we can.
Very good. I and my listeners appreciate you talking with us today, and we'll be in touch. Thanks for listening to Our Town Live, and don't forget to subscribe and give us a review.